All right, welcome to class, everyone. This is a great turnout. I just have to say it is. I just have to say it for the public record. It's great that we have multiple men here because that's so rare. So we commend you men for coming to talk about health. It's really exciting. And the class today is on mold and mold toxicity. And this actually wasn't in the original when I'd written out all the classes we were going to do, but it's definitely an important topic, so I'm glad we're going to discuss it. So let us pray. So Father, we pray for wisdom, insight, understanding to the human body, Lord. We know you made us in your image. We are beautiful creations. We know sin has tainted that to an extreme measure, Lord. And we want fullness. We want restoration. We want healing. We want to understand your ways. We want to understand how the world works that you designed. We know your heart, your desire is not to afflict sickness and disease upon us. So what is it that we can do, and how can we change, and how can we be obedient to how you designed us to live on this earth so that we can be free of these issues? And when we're talking about mold, Lord, we know this is an issue that's biblical, and we're looking for answers. We're just searching our hearts and for deeper understanding. Answers that we're not getting in the medical community, Lord, may you bring us revelation and wisdom that we may end some of the suffering that people are struggling with and realign with your heart and your design, for that is our ultimate goal. We pray in Jesus' name, amen. All right, so mold toxicity. This is a big topic. This is interesting. This is one of the best turnouts we've had for a class, and interesting that it's on mold. I never would have imagined, but I think it's great. So, mold is a big time problem. We have a mold remediator. Is that what you say? Remediator here in the class with us. How ironic is that? So, now I'm really nervous. No, I'm just kidding. So, a lot of people know mold's an issue because they've had mold in their homes, they've been exposed to it, and they know that it's a problem. But it's not just in our basements, in our crawl spaces, and in our attics, and in our moldy foods in the refrigerator, it's in our bodies. And a lot of people don't realize it. And a lot of people only realize it's in our bodies if they got exposed to it. They know they got exposed to the toxic black mold. That's the word we hear a lot, the black mold. And we know it's a serious problem. But what I really want to share with people is that this is a problem for tens of thousands, and I would probably even venture to say millions of people, at least across the globe, most of which those people are completely oblivious to how it's affecting their lives. And I would even venture to say that there are tens of thousands of people struggling with their health that have a mold or fungus toxicity in their body, and they have no idea. And the medical community has no idea. And people suffer for years and years and years, and they die prematurely, and it destroys their body from the inside out. So we know people are suffering from chronic illnesses. We know people are suffering from these diagnoses that don't mean much a lot of times, like chronic fatigue syndrome, or they put these different labels. Like, we did a class on lupus, which didn't mean much as far as the diagnosis goes. And people have Lyme disease. There's ways to test for that. But people have a lot of chronic, debilitating sickness and disease issues that they don't have a lot of answers for. And we're finding more and more that the main reason people are suffering with so many of these issues is infections. It's chronic infections in the body. And we don't think of the infection issue in the body unless we have a manifestation or a flare-up that's so bad that we can't function very well, so we go to the doctor to get an antibiotic or an antifungal or something to help with that immediate acute situation. But people are struggling and suffering and in pain and misery like their whole lives with these issues, but don't know it or don't know why or don't know the underlying cause of it. So I'm going to start with the Bible. I usually reference scriptures here and there, but the mold issue, it's a big deal in the Bible too. And so I just want to make it clear how big of a deal the mold issue was and how God handled it in the Old Testament, specific to the Levitical priesthood and how they would handle lepers. And if you think of, if you look in the Bible and you look at the word mold, they talk about mildew as a consuming illness, a consuming disease. It's one of the curses mentioned in Deuteronomy, that if we did not follow the ways of God. And lepers and leprosy was specifically tied to this mold and mildew issue. And so I'm going to read Deuteronomy 24:8, and then I'm going to summarize a couple things in Leviticus because it's just way too long to read. But Deuteronomy says 24:8, in 24:8 it says, "Be careful against an infection of leprosy, that you diligently observe and do according to all that the Levitical priests teach you, as I have commanded them, so you shall be careful to do." And then in Leviticus, so what were the Levitical priests, what were they trained by God to do with a leper, or it goes hand in hand, this mold or mildew issue? So I'm just going to summarize Leviticus 12. It's 33 through 57. You can read it on your own. I'm sure some of you guys have ran across it maybe sometime in your biblical journey, but I don't know if you've heard too many like preaching sermons on it or anything. But this is a summary of it, okay? If you find a mark, they call it a mark, and this is inside of a leper's house, that is greenish or reddish. Okay, you guys have seen mold, all right? It can be different colors. There's different varieties of mold. But it says, if you find a mark that's greenish or reddish, you quarantine the home for 7 days. Quarantine for 7 days. That alone tells you it's serious, right? After the 7 days, if they found that it spreads, tear out all the stones or any part of that house that contains that mold and bring it outside the city to an unclean place. He specifically says, bring it to an unclean place. So in our day, that would be like the landfill, right? That's an unclean place. And then scrape down the entire rest of the house and replace the stones. If it breaks out again, what? Tear it down. Tear the whole house down, every piece of it, take every single piece of that entire home and bring it out to that unclean place. So mold's a big deal. So, and he also says at the end of that, he said, whoever would have eaten or slept in that place is unclean, and they must wash their clothes. So I'm just trying to stress the fact that mold is a serious issue. In Deuteronomy 28, he talked, and I'm not going to read the whole scripture, but he talks about how the Lord is going to send curses and confusion and rebukes and destruction upon us if we don't follow and walk in the ways of God. And I've talked about that in classes before. God didn't give us cancer and heart disease and diabetes. We're clearly walking outside of some of God's principles on how we're supposed to live in the world that he created. But he talks about how he will smite us. I'm just going to read the scripture. He will smite us with consumption, with fever, with inflammation and fiery heat, the sword, and with blight and with mildew. Mildew, that's that same word that they use with mold. Mildew, and they will pursue you until you perish. And one of the things that I am proposing to us today is that people are being consumed by mold and mildew, and they don't know it. Now, I've given the example many times in classes before of the fish tank example. You know, God designed our bodies to be free-flowing, clean rivers of life. And if you don't take care of your fish tank right, it starts to get some algae and grow some things in it. And the same thing in your basement. If you don't clean out your basement and take care of it, or you get a crack in where your shower is and under the tiles, funky stuff starts to grow, right? But our bodies are the same way. If they're not clean, flowing rivers and they're not functioning the way God designed it, and you get exposed to something that is an infectious organism, it can take over and consume our bodies. We don't talk about it a lot The medical community doesn't talk about it a lot because all we talk about is when we get a cold or a flu. And you know, we take some antibiotics or we take XYZ drug or we just hold out and, you know, take some herbs or whatever. But these issues are consuming people from the inside out. You look at people with debilitative brain dysfunction, you know, dementia and Alzheimer's and whatever, you can actually see it happening to people. I know that because I've seen it happen to people I know. I know what was happening to them. It's hard to even talk to them about it or explain to them what's happening because how do you even deal with it? But basically, when the body gets overtaken by an infection and you have sickness in your body, you have diseased necrotic tissue in your body, you have weak tissue in your body, it can just live there. And in fact, it can thrive and it can survive. And people know who've been infested with mold, it's very, very, very hard to get rid of in your house and in your body. And you need to call an expert. You know, you need to call somebody who knows what they're doing to get this stuff out of your house because it can destroy an entire family. So I put that as kind of the first step of is detection and removal. Detection and removal. Whether it's in your home, whether it's in your work environment, people work in restaurants, people have had these like walk-in coolers that they had for 20, 30 years and there's mold growing all over the, you know, the steel, you know what I'm talking about, you've seen it. Just nasty, nasty stuff. And so, again, if your body's weak, your terrain's weak and that gets into your body, a mold spore can grow and start to reproduce by the billions and literally start to take over the human body. That's gross. Like, we don't even want to think of that. Like, it just sounds crazy. Hurricane Katrina. You guys all remember Hurricane Katrina. What was that, 10 years ago? That was a while ago, wasn't it? It's a long time ago. There's a family, and this happened to thousands and thousands of families down there. But there's this one particular family. After Hurricane Katrina, they stayed in their home, and they started getting sick. And it started to get pretty, the whole family, burning in their chest, itchy, watery, painful eyes. And they finally figured out that they had mold toxicity. So their house had flooded. I mean, I can't imagine how much of a nightmare that was down there, this mold issue in a place that floods. And it got worse. They actually started to have major lung issues and it can cause lung failure and collapse of the respiratory system as it takes over the lungs and the body. And even after they moved out of the house, it continued. Their health issues continued because they've already been exposed to it. It had already taken root in their bodies and in their lungs and in their respiratory tract. And they actually wrote a book about it, and it's called Mold, The War Within. And I have that book. But it's fascinating, this family's journey on discovering and dealing with this mold issue. And again, you know, mainstream medical community, they don't really check for it. They don't test for it. It's not well recognized. Let's just say that is a major issue. And we need to have better testing methods to check for things like mold. And I'm going to give you an option of a way you can test for mold. I thought this was fascinating. So everybody's heard of King Tut, right? Okay, do you know what happened to the group of explorers or the guys who discovered King Tut's tomb? What happened to them? They all died. They went into King Tut's tomb, they discovered King Tut's tomb, and shortly thereafter, they all died. And you know what they called it? A curse. The curse of King Tut's tomb. You know what they found really killed them? Mold. Mold that was living and surviving in this tomb for thousands of years. And the mold spores were so strong in there that as soon as they went in there and inhaled that, it literally started to consume their bodies. So that's why, check your house. If you have any kind of respiratory issues, sickness, even if you don't, check your house. You do not want to mess with this mold thing at all. All right. What they do in the medical system is they treat it, unfortunately, like they treat so many other illnesses and diseases. They treat it with the drugs that they have and that they know, the pharmaceutical drugs, the petrochemicals. Steroids are commonly used for these types of issues. Antibiotics rarely touch it because it's more in the mold fungus category, much stronger than some of your basic bacterial organisms. And so antibiotics aren't really going to touch it. They have to get into the strong antifungals like Diflucan and Nystatin, and you know, there's all kinds of different ones out there. But they come with some nasty, nasty side effects. You know the stuff you can go buy in the drugstore that you can put on your toenail fungus? What's it called? Nobody knows that? Lamisil. Have you guys heard of Lamisil before? You can put it on your toenail fungus and it'll kill your toenail fungus. This is made by a company called Novartis that's a big chemical company. Here's the side effects listed on Lamisil. Liver failure, need of liver transplants, lupus, and death. And you can buy it in the drugstore. So yeah, I mean, if it's going to kill you, it's probably going to kill your nail fungus, right? But why would you have that in your house? You know, what if your kid got a hold of that? What if your dog got a hold of that? I mean, what a nightmare. You know how many kids and animals have been killed by the medical industry because children accidentally got into stuff at home? This stuff is poison. It shouldn't even be on the market. But that's our world. That's America for you. So these drugs, triazole is another one. When you use these drugs, they might kill some mold spores. They might kill some infection, but this stuff gets systemic in our bodies. And it's going to provide maybe temporary relief, but there's always the side effect of how it damages and weakens the immune system. Almost anybody who's interested at all in health these days understands the pros and cons, the risks of doing antibiotics and antifungals at the expense of our long-term health and our immune system, and we know it weakens the body overall. So that's not going to be any different. Steroids I have a major issue with, and I'm gonna share why with you right now, because it's very fitting to this mold class that we're talking about, because the way these issues manifest mainly is respiratory issues. How many people do you know struggle with respiratory issues? Hard to get a breath, always getting reoccurring infections in the lungs, maybe pneumonia one time and then bronchitis, and they're always getting colds and flus and it manifests in their chest, having just trouble even feeling like you can get a deep breath. How about people with chronic sinus issues? People getting sinus surgeries, diagnosed with sinusitis. What do we think's going on in the respiratory tract? It's infection. We have fungal infections in our sinus cavity. We do all kinds of over-the-counter Claritin and Sudafed and all this crazy stuff. We never do anything to deal with the fungus that's living in our sinus cavity, that's making our lives miserable. And we sell a $13 sinus spray that that kills the fungus. And it saves people from sinus surgery. And it's helped tens of thousands of people. There's simple solutions to these things, but the medical system doesn't have good solutions because the drugs weaken your immune system. They don't target, you know, it kills everything and it just leaves you in a weakened state. One of the biggest issues I have with steroid use, because, you know, many people have used steroids and maybe they used steroids one or two times and the body kind of took care of the issue. They didn't have to use them again. Okay, great. But way too many people are living on steroids, using it to get out of pain, using it for inflammation. And I want to give you one of the most dangerous examples of where you can use steroids. And I pretty much guarantee you that every single one of you know somebody that has this issue. And it's called asthma. You guys know somebody who has asthma? Okay, what's asthma? Yeah, you can't breathe. Your lungs, something's disabling your lungs to breathe. Well, what do we think is disabling your lungs from breathing? It's certainly not a deficiency in steroids, right? I mean, there's something going on in our lungs. And what it is, it's an infection. And when do these things flare up for somebody who's asthmatic? If they exercise too much, right? Or if they're stressed out, or maybe they just have a really bad weekend of eating a lot of junk. All those things are going to flare up an infection in your body. So most asthmatics, their lungs are riddled with some type of bacteria, yeast, fungus, mold, some type of infection that's trapped all up in the mucus. The body's creating tons of mucus. Why does the body create mucus? To keep the body clean, to move out infections. You know, when you get sick, you get a cold or flu, you create more mucus, you're snotting all over the place. Everybody, get away from me, I'm all snotty. Right? Your body's creating that because your immune system's fighting, it's killing infection, and it's removing it through the mucus. So people asthmatic have tons and tons of built-up mucus and congestion and sickness in their lungs. And so when you have a exercise-induced asthma attack, you're getting oxygen into your lungs. Your body's stimulating a healing response, trying to kick sickness and disease out of your lungs. And what do? We push it back in with a steroid. So steroids suppresses the immune system response. It's one of the most dangerous things that suppress and weaken and damage the immune system. And what you're doing is you're allowing the sickness to stay rooted in your lungs. Because you never deal with the infection. Again, a major issue with our medical community is they don't really understand sickness and disease. As crazy as that sounds, they don't have any idea of the depth of understanding sickness and disease. How is a solution for somebody who has asthma, who has a lung problem, a steroid inhaler for the rest of your life? How is that an answer to helping somebody heal of a sickness? It's not. And when they instituted cortisone and steroids as the main therapy for asthmatics in the 1970s and started giving that to every single person diagnosed with asthma, asthma death rates tripled. And the reason asthma death rates are so high is because you never deal with the disease. You never deal with the sickness and the damage in your lungs. In fact, you continue to suppress, weaken, and damage your immune system and push the disease back deeper into your lungs by suppressing it with steroids. Does that make sense? It seems so common sense. It seems so obvious. And so I have friends, I have family members who are asthmatic and use an inhaler. And like, oh, life is good. You just go on, do whatever. You have a little flare-up, take your asthma. You know, everything's good. And then you get so much sickness built up in your lungs that you have an attack that your body, it just can't deal with it anymore. And people can't breathe. They actually die from it. And so it's really sad. And so we have to deal with the mold issue. We have to deal with the infection that's actually in the body if we're going to overcome these issues. All right, so I wanted to talk a little bit more about the symptoms of it, because every asthma symptom is going to be related to this type of infectious issue in your body. And again, if you have bronchitis, pneumonia, there's different types of bacterial organisms out there. Okay, not everybody who has an infection has mold, but a lot of people have mold and they don't know it. That's one of my main points. Weather changes. Okay, how many people like do great in the summer? Maybe their best time is in the summer. Maybe they also do good when it's really cold in the winter, but they really struggle in the spring and in the fall. Okay, that's usually because of an infection in the body. Oh, my sinuses they always start killing me this time of the year. Okay, is it just pollen floating around in the air, or do you have an infection in your respiratory tract, in your lymph, which is part of your immune system? This whole system is the lymph system. The tonsils, the adenoids, the sinus cavity, that's all part of the lymph system, the mucosal systems of the body. And so why do people move to Phoenix, Arizona? You ever known anybody who moved to warmer weather because they just felt better health-wise? Okay, why? Because they have infections in their body. And you know what infections like? They like cold, wet, damp, moldy environments. Just like Kansas City. That's why it's a big, big, big issue here. Okay? I don't know how much work you'd have in Phoenix, Arizona as a mold remediator. Not near as much as you'd have here.
It's
right?
Surprising as a lot.
Even there too.
Yes.
Yeah, so it's everywhere. It's everywhere. But mold is not going to survive in 110 degrees sun shining on it. Like, mold is killed by sunshine, by high heat temperatures, by dry temperatures. What else does mold and infectious organisms live on? Water, right? So, you know, you got an old, moldy, nasty bucket of water. You throw the water out, eventually all the mold spores and the fungus and everything dies. So, so the weather changes, that's what I was talking about. The weather changes is because a lot of people have infections in their body. They feel the pressure changes. When it gets kind of into the fall weather, the cold, wet, more fall weather, or the spring weather, their joints start aching. You know, arthritis. We did class on arthritis, but we talked about how there's infections in the joints. There's bacteria and infections in the joints causing a lot of the pain and the suffering because it's attracted to the acidic waste that's built up there because the bacteria is trying to break down the acid waste that's not supposed to be in your body. This is all God's design. And we just think the body's failing and we're falling apart because we're getting older. You know, where our bodies just aren't flowing and functioning the way God designed them to function. The other thing you can, okay, so yeah, so weather changes, itchy eyes, itchy ears, itchy nose, respiratory issues, sinus issues. Okay, don't just assume it's, oh, well, it's just spring. It happens to me every year and it's because of the pollen in the air. Okay, many people have much, much deeper issues that never get addressed. And if your goal is health and your goal is longevity and your goal is to be around for, you know, your grandchildren for dozens of years or whatever, like, you can't just treat symptoms with drugs. We got to break that mindset. And we got to use just common sense in our brain that if I take a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug or a drug that lowers my blood pressure or a drug that, you know, kills an infection once in a while or a steroid that takes down my pain, we're not doing anything to heal the body. We're not helping God in the way He designed us to function. We're suppressing, in fact, we're suppressing and working against God's design. And I've said that many times. When you use pharmaceutical drugs, you are putting something in your body that's working against how God designed your body to function. Because if your lungs are flaring up and you're trying to hack up mucus and congestion and sickness and disease out of your lungs and you take a steroid, you're working against what God is trying to do to heal you. Because God created you. He designed you. He loved you. He designed you to heal as a self-healing mechanism. And we're creating an entire system that's focused on pushing down and working against God's creation of the human body. And I was oblivious to this, and most people are oblivious to this until they hear it, until somebody tells them the truth about it. All right, so you can get tested for mold. I don't have any idea how the medical system tests for mold. I don't know, maybe at the end of class, if you have any idea how people can test for mold, you know, if you've run into people who have it in their house, how do I know if I have it in my body? But I do a test called an OATS test, and it's called an organic acids test. And there's 18 different markers you can test for because infectious organisms have waste product, a product of metabolism. Everything has a metabolic waste to it in your body. You know, your vitamins, your minerals, your amino acids. And so there's 18 markers on this test called an OATS test. It's through Great Plains Laboratory. And it's a urine test. And these 18 markers are for yeast, fungus, mold, clostridia, aspergillus, which is a specific type of mold that's a big issue in a lot of people's lungs and respiratory tract. And so you can test to see if you have these metabolites coming out of your urine. And if they're present, that means you have candida, yeast, fungus, mold, infection in your body. So it's good to know that, especially if you have a respiratory issue or any digestion issues or a sinus issue. Just don't take it for granted. Like, find out what's going on in your body. So let's talk about how to remove mold or deal with the mold issue if it's in your body, if you have asthma, if you have, if you know you're exposed to the black mold, or even if you just have major, major respiratory issues. I know people that have had, you know, lung cancer, for example. Okay, you might have smoked for a long period of time. You probably got lots of toxins and poisons from the cigarette smoke in your lungs, but I guarantee you also have infectious disease also in those lungs. because that always comes along with toxicity in the body. When you have toxic waste buildup in the body, it always attracts bacteria and infectious organisms. Why? Because God designed them to break down and remove toxic organisms. That's how it works in the soil, and it's also how it works in our body. I did a whole series on that called Foundation of Creation, where I mirrored Genesis 2:7, how God formed us out of dust of the earth, and how that system of how the earth works is how our bodies work. So the first thing is diet. And so this is the fun one, right? To talk about how do you, everybody's probably heard, if they've struggled with these issues, the famous candida diet. Any woman with a yeast issue or reoccurring yeast infections, people have heard about the, anti-candida diet, and it's a reality. It's just a reality, because what do infectious organisms, all of them, live off of, but especially candida and mold and fungus organisms? What do they live off of?
Sugar.
They all live off of sugar. The main two things they need to survive are water and sugar. If you take out the water, they're all going to die. And if you take out the sugar, you can starve them out. So there's no way around this. There's no, well, I don't eat Wonder Bread and I eat whole grain bread. No, in fact, it's actually sprouted Ezekiel bread. That's okay, right? It's still bread. It's still starch. It's still going to feed yeast and fungus and mold in the body. Anybody who's had these issues, know that's absolutely 100% true. Because they've had their moments of eating donuts and burgers and french fries and chocolate shakes and I'm tired of this diet, I'm just going to go eat whatever. And they're miserable, because the fungus or the mold flares up in their body. And so a lot of times we roller coaster on the diet, but there's no easy way out of it. If your immune system's weak, you've been exposed to these types of issues, there's no way around it outside of eliminating dairy, grains, and sugar. Those are the big three, dairy, grains, and sugar. That's all sugars, including fruit. That's all grains, even doesn't matter if it's rice. All dairy, because there's sugar in dairy, and even if it's fermented, it takes out the lactose or the milk sugar, but it's still a heavy congesting mucus forming food. And if your body's full of congestion and mucus, you don't want to add more mucus forming heavy foods into your diet. And a lot of people know they don't do well with dairy. The other thing is starchy carbohydrates. This is your potatoes. This is your chickpeas and hummus. Peanuts. So we have to remove all of these starchy, carby, sugary foods. And whether you have an infection or not, every single person who has removed sugars and starches from their diet for any period of time knows that they feel better. Who can raise their hand and say, yes, I felt better when I stopped eating sugars and carbs for a while? Almost everybody's experienced that. So we know it. So clearly there's something going on inside our bodies that's not working for. Those foods aren't working for. I gave you a list of the top 10 foods to avoid if you have a mold sensitivity. And you'll notice a theme here. Alcohol is mostly made from what? Grains, right? Wheat, rye, cottonseed, barley, sorghum, these are all grains. Why are grains so moldy? Part of it, it kills fungus and yeast and mold. We use it in our bathtubs and our showers and our refrigerator to keep everything fresh. And you can actually put a little bit in water and drink it every day. The bicarbonate minerals are great for the kidneys. It kills fungus and yeast and mold on contact. That's what Dr. Simicini used, this doctor in Italy, who lost his license for curing people of cancer with baking soda. This is what he used to see cancer tumors go away, is he used baking soda. So you just put a little bit in water and drink it, best on an empty stomach. You don't want to dilute your stomach acid while you're eating food. So it's good on an empty stomach. Sauna, dry sauna, not the heat sauna, not the wet sauna, not the steam sauna. A dry far infrared sauna or infrared sauna. Or there's near and far, and I don't know all the difference between them, but a dry sauna, the heat kills infection. What happens when you get sick? You get a fever. That's the body's natural mechanism to heat up. That's God's design to heat up to kill and eradicate an infection in your body. And so a sauna will heat up your body and kill infection in your body. It'll also help you sweat, because there's only three ways to get waste out of the human body, right? Poop, pee, and sweat. And people are sick, and if you're not eliminating properly, or doing enemas, or having dark, cloudy, stinky pee, or sweating, all the toxic waste is staying trapped in the body. And so that's why people don't get well. That's why a pharmaceutical drug will never make you well. It might make you feel temporarily better, but it won't make you well. You will never have the fullness of God's design. Like it almost seems like a fantasy these days for our bodies to work and function the way God designed them. And can you imagine like how amazingly powerful like Adam was? Like, I can't even imagine that. Like how well his body functioned and the way he thought, like even after sin, beyond comprehension, a million times more strong and powerful than we are today. Just so much genetic weakness passed down. But God has promised us fullness and he's promised us restoration. But we really have to go for it. Enemas, I'm a fan of. It just helps people feel better. It eliminates infection more quickly. There's black walnut. You can use baking soda. You can use all kinds of different herbs and things to kill infection in your colon, in your body. It not only removes waste out of your colon, but all the gut-associated lymphatic tissue that's all around your that's around your intestines. It's lymphatic tissue. And all that stuff needs to be cleaned out. So that's the answer long term, is cleansing. And that's why so many people will succumb to sickness and disease and won't live long, healthy lives, is because we were never taught and we never learned to cleanse, or we're so ingrained in food and the foods that we like and pleasure us and that we're addicted to that we won't break out of that to restore health in our bodies. That's just the reality. Kind of our world today. It's just like anything in your walk with the Lord, it's a choice to turn away from destructive things. It's a choice to turn back to the author of life, to choose back to God. You know, whether your issue is alcohol or pornography or food, these are things that, you know, we have to make the decision, and we have to make the difficult choices, and we have to make the change. And it doesn't happen to happen overnight. It can be a transition. It's a process. You know, I don't want everybody to feel guilty about the holidays now. And oh my gosh, I went to Thanksgiving, I ate a piece of pie. You know, like we don't want condemnation over this, but we have to learn the reality of what it takes to heal our bodies. And we're not doing it. We're not doing what it takes to heal our bodies, because it takes discipline and it takes self-control and it takes work and it takes being different from everybody else. And it takes your family and friends saying things about you that they shouldn't say, that they don't have any right to say, but they choose to say it, probably because they're convicted by your choices to go morally a different way, which I know we've probably all experienced that in some arena of our lives. So anyway, that was it. Blessings. Amen. If anybody has any questions, comments.
Potatoes, that sweet potatoes also?
Yes, potatoes would include sweet potatoes. Not as much of an extent, but yes, it's a starchy food. And so it's going to include potatoes. So what I always tell people is, you know, if you like sweet potatoes, there's a give and take here, right? Let's say you love sweet potatoes. You really love sweet potatoes. But you also eat ice cream and bread and crackers and pasta. If you give all that other stuff up and you just eat sweet potatoes, that's a fair trade to me. Do you see what I'm saying? There's got to be a give and take. So, because we're always so particular about each and every food or whatever. Well, it depends on where you're at. So if you're just starting to make changes, you know, get rid of all the worst stuff first. You know, if you're eating ice cream at night, every night before bed, yeah, eat your sweet potato. If you cut out the ice cream, right?
So.
Butternut squash is a starchy vegetable. It's not as bad. Body Ecology Diet, she recommends mainly staying away from corn and potatoes. Squash is a little bit more on the starchy side. I would just limit it. I wouldn't say it's like ixnayed from the candida list. It's better than sweet potato, for sure. It's definitely better than sweet potato. Yes. Anything else? Yes.
You mentioned a probiotic. What about kimchi?
Yes, so he said, you mentioned probiotics, what about kimchi? So with yeast, fungal, mold issues, I recommend sauerkraut, kimchi, or any fermented vegetables. Ideally, well, I was going to say not in vinegar, but it shouldn't be in vinegar if it's fermented, okay? Because vinegar kills infections and it feeds yeast. Not to do dairy, so no yogurt or kefir. A lot of people would disagree and say all the healthy organisms in yogurt and kefir are very good for these issues. Yes, but from my experience, the dairy is too heavy, mucus forming, congesting. People got blocked lymphatic systems, livers aren't working. You're just not going to do well in dairy, period. And then kombucha is a wild fermentation that actually feeds yeast and fungus in the body. So I do not recommend kombucha for these issues either. So I only recommend sauerkraut or kimchi and good probiotics.
Say that again about the kombucha.
Kombucha is a wild fermentation. It feeds yeast and fungus, just like wine does, just like beer does. Beer is about, you want to know like the single worst thing you could put in the human body, in my opinion, is beer. Let me tell you a story real quick. This is a good story. Do I have enough time on the camera? Okay. I learned this just this last, I have to share this with you. I've been meaning to share this in a class and it hasn't come up. Okay, you guys have all heard of Pocahontas. Okay, we went to Henricus, which is the second settlement built after Jamestown. It's where Pocahontas lived and where she met with the pastor to learn English. So not only did she learn the American way, or probably more like the English way, right? The English civilized way, and learning about the Bible and learning about English language and all that, she also started eating the food that they ate. Now when Pocahontas first started learning all this, she was really young. She was about 16. And she ate the Native American diet, right? They ate squash and corn, and they ate deer and animals that they caught, and rabbit, and you know, this is what they ate. When she met the English settlers, you know what their three main foods were? I'll tell you what are their three main foods? Anybody have any idea? Beer was one.
Potatoes.
Nope. Bread was one. And cheese. Beer, bread, and cheese. I mean, what are people still addicted to today, right? Beer, bread, and cheese. Okay, she had never seen these foods before in her life. Why did they drink beer? Because they didn't have a good way to sanitize and purify water. And the beer was fermented. So that was actually the main beverage that they drank was beer. So beer, bread, and cheese. She started eating beer, bread, and cheese. She always complained of stomach issues and stomach problems after she started eating that. And she was deathly sick. There's a couple pictures that an artist drew of her, and she looks thin, she looks gaunt. She almost looks like she has rheumatoid arthritis, like her fingers are starting to cripple. They brought her over to England. And in England, it's all like hoity-toity, you know, party after party. She's probably drinking alcohol, eating cheese, eating bread. How many people know Pocahontas was dead at 21? So healthy Native American living off of the land started eating this civilized English food, suffered for those 5 years, and was dead in 5 years, dead at 21. Who's heard that story? This is the result of choosing these foods and this type of a lifestyle. Now, it was different back then for the settlers. Their bodies were used to it. They were working outside. They were sweating, building stuff or whatever. They didn't die because they were eating beer and bread. Okay, but our culture's different. Our foods are different. Our environment's different. We're sedentary. We don't move and exercise and sweat like we used to. You have to be super intentional to be healthy today. Don't end up like Pocahontas. I just wanted to share that. I thought that was good. Okay. Was there any other questions? Yes.
Is a HEPA filter okay to use?
I actually didn't mention the filters. I'm glad you mentioned it. We have the Volara Air Fresh systems. It's an ozone machine. It actually puts ozone into the air. And that's what you want, because ozone will kill mold and fungus on contact. It'll hit it. It'll render it inert. It'll fall right out. And they got tests and stuff that they can show that to you in a little bubble. But So I think anything that puts oxygen into the air, like ozone, hydrogen peroxide kills mold. You know, you can use that. I don't know about just a regular, he might speak more, but just in a plain old HEPA filter, I'm sure if it's a super high quality, like official HEPA filters, because I know there's a lot of off, not good brands out there, I think it probably does help to some extent. But I know the ozone machines work great for killing the mold. Yes, sure. Anything else?
Can you say more about that kombucha?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that was your question. I never answered your question.
Well, the reason I'm asking is because I just made it.
Okay.
I'm just making it.
So beer, wine, they're called wild fermentations. There's actually a book out called Wild Fermentation. But it's a different process of fermentation. I don't fully understand it. I'm not a fermentation expert. But sauerkraut and kimchi are fermented. Beer and wine are fermented. Beer and wine will make your yeast and fungus in your body go crazy, flip out. Sauerkraut and kimchi will actually be healing to the body, good for your healthy bacteria. It's a difference in the fermentation process. And maybe actually the fact that sauerkraut and kimchi are from vegetables, sauerkraut, versus a base that's grapes or fruit sugar or the grains, you know, which we talked about the issue with grains and mold and stuff like that. And the kombucha is a bacteria of culture in yeast. It's called a SCOBY. Yeah. I don't know if anybody really knows what it is. Some people say it's a mushroom. I've heard it's not really a mushroom. It's a culture of bacteria and yeast. I don't know where it came from or where it originated from, but I know the process of fermentation is a process that will feed yeast and fungus in the body if you have it. I know this from experience with working with people, but also in Body Ecology Diet, Donna Gates knows this and does not recommend kombucha for that purpose. But if you don't have those issues, people talk all the time about how great kombucha is.
It's probiotic.
Great, probiotic, good for digestion, got B vitamins in it. There's a lot of benefits to kombucha, but if you have a yeast fungus issue, you're not going to do well on it. All right? Okay, yes, last question. I don't. I've never hired I don't think I've ever had to hire a mold remediator or somebody, but I'm sure they're in the phone book. I just don't know anybody personally. He might. All right. Amen. Thanks.
Thank you.
This is our industrialized system, the weakness of how they grow the food now, the pesticides and herbicides they use, of course, but they don't use the right practices to fully dry and eliminate fungus and mold that grows on grains. And so organic's probably not going to help, because the organic just means no herbicides and pesticides. It doesn't mean it's going to be free of fungus and mold. And so all grains, so yeah, we've all heard about eliminating grains because of the gluten issue, but it goes way beyond that. It's because of this fungus mold issue going on inside people's body. And so when you eat foods that are contaminated with fungus and mold, it's going to flare up this issue. It's going to feed that infection in your body and you're going to feel worse. And so that's going to be all grains, peanuts. Now, peanuts aren't a nut. They're a legume. They're starch. The average peanut, they did some testing on peanuts. They found anywhere from a minimum of 24 different types of mold and fungus on peanuts. And so all nuts, to some extent, can have mold on them. The one that they most recommend that you're most likely not to have a lot of mold on is almonds. That's the main one they recommend. But anything that grows in the ground can potentially be moldy, right? And so peanuts is probably the most moldy. And one of the main funguses and the nastiest fungus on peanuts is something called aflatoxin. And aflatoxin is a known carcinogen. It's a known cancer-causing agent. And it's a fungus. It's a mold. There's a whole book written by, I think he wrote a book, Dr. C. Massini. It's a guy in Italy who wrote Cancer's a Fungus. And he talked about fungus, yeast, mold in the body, and how that suffocates the body. The body can't thrive in, the cells can't thrive in oxygen the way they designed them. They switch into an anaerobic form, which is living without oxygen, which lives off of sugar products, fermentation of sugar. And the mold, the fungus, the sugar start to consume the human body. This is cancer. I mean, we did like four classes on cancer. Okay, cancer isn't some mysterious illness that just strikes out of thin air. Okay, there's cause and effect to God's world and his laws of creation and design. So so you can read the rest of the foods. Corn is a big one, a big time moldy food. And then all sugar. All sugar, sugar cane, sugar beets. Of course, cheeses. Like, whose favorite cheese is blue cheese? That's the moldy one, right? All right. Here's the hard part. Again, this is a perfect quote. I think it was Don Colbert that said that. Sorry, I put that on YouTube. I hope that's not wrong. He's a Christian guy who's really into health and has helped a lot of people. And I think it was him. If not him, I'm sure many people have said this. The foods that you crave are the ones that are killing you. Right? Why else would it be a craving? What do alcoholics crave? Right? What you crave is killing you. Now, if you want to talk about, you know, from a biblical standpoint, God doesn't want anything interfering with our relationship with him. He doesn't want us craving anything outside of him, especially food. It's one of the biggest idols in the church. Nobody talks about it. But if anything you're craving, it is probably not good for your body. Now, I know people who crave tomatoes and, you know, things that are healthy. But very rarely is anything of God's design that's a fruit or a vegetable, a craving to the point of an addiction. Like, has anybody here been addicted to avocados? I love avocados. I don't think I'm addicted to them, though. But the sweets, the sugar, I mean, coffee, people are addicted to coffee. Clearly, that's an issue if you can't stop drinking it. So I just have to say that because one of the biggest challenges to people getting well is that they're craving what isn't right for their bodies and what's not good for them and what's blocking and impeding them from healing and getting well. I mean, who here has struggled with sugar cravings? Do we want to be honest? Do we want to do an altar call real quick? No, I'm just kidding. So, I mean, we've all struggled with sugar cravings. We've all struggled with sugar cravings. So I had a gal, just give you an example. This just popped into my mind. I had a gal in my office Friday for an appointment. Her and her husband were both together. And he knew he was struggling with some fungal yeast issues. And she said, I struggled with these same issues about 10 years ago. If it was sugar, if it was sweet, if I was in a room with it, I literally could not control myself. If it was in the room, forget it. I knew it was bad for me. It could be a donut, the worst thing you could possibly eat, right? And she would eat it because she had no control. But as she worked on her health, as she worked on stop eating sugar, cleansing her body, getting into a healthier place, she goes, this whole room right now could be full of donuts and I wouldn't blink an eye. In fact, you're almost repulsed by it. But it takes time. It takes effort. And a lot of that is because the infection, the sickness, the disease, the mold, the yeast, the fungus, what's in our body is driving those cravings. It's not you. It's not who you are. It's not who God designed you to be. God wants you to step out of that and find healing from that. And so part of that is actually finding healing in our physical bodies. So we definitely want to get rid of all the high mold-containing foods. You can look at a diet called the Body Ecology Diet. It's probably my favorite program. It's designed specifically for people with candida yeast type of overgrowth. It's helped tens of thousands of, whether it's a woman with a yeast infection or autism, every end of the spectrum. She has a 10-CD series on autism. And how many children have been healed of autism, ADD, ADHD, mental disorders, digestive disorders, by getting away from sugars, starches, and carbohydrates for many reasons, but the main reason is because people's bodies are riddled with infection. We have young children who are autistic whose guts are completely destroyed by yeast, fungus, and mold organisms. You can test for it and you can find it. And what do these children crave? What can you not get in, get them to stop eating? Carbs, bread, sugar, sweets. It's like uncontrollable. 2, 3, 4-year-old children. It's because the sickness in them is driving the craving. I can't stress that enough. Because if you're battling food addiction right now, you might just think you're weak and you're not strong enough and you're not giving it all to the Lord like you're supposed to. And I'm not saying there's not a component to that. But what I have been called to share with people is that real physical sickness and disease in your body can affect your mental function and it can affect your walk with the Lord. And we have to heal our physical bodies because we're designed to have fullness in body, soul, and spirit. And so, just like the gal I mentioned last week, when she worked on her health, when she eliminated, you know, the carby, starchy, sugary stuff, she found better health in her bodies, those cravings went away. That doesn't drive her anymore. That's not her focus anymore. Too much, our focus is on what we're going to eat, when we're going to eat, how we're going to eat. I mean, we are consumed by food. So I've talked a lot about that in other classes, so I won't go deep into that. But when you have infections in your body, they create a lot of acid waste byproducts. Acetaldehyde and other toxins, alcohol byproducts. They affect the brain. They affect your mind. They affect your gut and your digestion. They affect your neurotransmitter levels. You think you can link infections in the body to depression? You bet. 100%. Any type of mental dysfunction, you bet. Because neurotransmitters stop working. Dopamine, serotonin, they stop working in the body. Something about the waste byproducts of these infections that have taken over the body keep the brain from working right. So we got to deal with this issue. Oxalic acid, which a lot of people think of when they think of kidney stones or oxalate stones in the kidneys. There's foods that are high in oxalic acid, but all these infectious organisms, mold creates high levels of oxalates in the body. They start to deposit in the muscles and the joints and cause debilitating pain in people. And they don't know why they have pain. Again, that's why the testing can help. I do these tests through Great Plains Lab now. It's awesome because people have, you know, you can see in their gut this overgrowth issue of mold and candida, and their dopamine's way low, their serotonin's way low, their oxalic acid's way high. And you can see it's all caused by these infections in the body. And people live for years and years and years suffering. Our children have these issues that are 2 years old. Parents never find out root cause why, or they don't get any education about it from a biblical standpoint or the way God designed us. They go to the medical doctors and their kids are suffering. You know, met way too many young children and teenagers that are really, really struggling and suffering and have no answers outside of taking some type of a drug to maintain it or taking some really, really strong drugs when something flares up. And it's just not a good way to live. It's not, again, God had better intentions for us in our bodies. All right, so there's three main ways, and I kind of gave you guys this mold. I don't know, I just felt motivated to kind of create like a little mold. And I put yeast, fungus, candida. I kind of lump them into one because different herbs and therapies kill these same organisms. There was who did that? I think it was Robert O. Young, maybe. There were a couple of guys who threw blood, looking at blood under a microscope, they could look at a bacteria in a microscope and see it change and morph from a bacteria into a fungus into a mold and back again. Okay, so as I've talked about in classes before, your body's only as healthy as the fluids in which your cells are swimming. And if your cells are swimming in toxic waste, you're going to get bacteria, fungus, and mold to start overtake the body. And so, why did I say that? So anyway, these organisms can change and they can morph. And what can happen is they can change from these nasty fungus mold organisms back into harmless organisms based on the environment in which they're exposed to. And he did this in like petri dishes. And so when they put oxygen and flowing water and, you know, things back into it, it either killed the organism or it actually morphed back into a, what would you call it, a non-dangerous, benign organism, right? Think of cancer, benign malignant, right? So yeah, I created this little, call it a cleanse. It's really more of a program on how to overcome mold toxicity in your body. And again, anybody with reoccurring respiratory infections, especially asthma, you know, you really want to get to the root of what's going on. The first step is the diet, and I kind of go through that a little bit. Exercise and movement, that's the key. Exercise and movement, a free-flowing river. The blood, the cardiovascular system, the lymph, the lymphatic system, those systems have to be clean and flowing. It's stagnant fluids in the body that create sickness and disease, just as the stagnant pond down the river you wouldn't want to swim in. So we got to get the body moving. So it's a combination of these things. It's the diet change not to feed the infection in the body, especially when you're talking something as nasty as mold. The diet not to feed the infection, movement to get the blood flowing and the lymph flowing. And then step three, I put, is the removing the mold, killing the mold or the fungus. Now what people do is they never learn about diet, they never change their diet, they're eating all kinds of sugars and carbs and starches because that's just kind of what people do and they're kind of addicted to. They go take a antifungal drug like a nystatin or whatever, and it's going to come back. They never dealt with the issue. And so if you can couple the nutrition along with things that actually kill and remove fungus and mold out of the body, you can feel unbelievably better in a week. I tell people, give it a month, but you'll be a brand new person. People have been suffering and struggling. No energy, chronic fatigue, feeling horrible all day, every day. In a month, they're completely different people. And I can say that just because I've seen it in many, many, many people. So the things that kill... you know what? I kind of got ahead of myself. So the first thing, I'm gonna look at this this little protocol I designed. And there's three steps to removing the mold, fungus, candida, yeast from your body, because I'm lumping them all together. Foundational stuff first. Okay, there's certain things your body has to have to function. Certain things your immune system needs, your cells need, and it's building a healthy foundation or a terrain. And so the first thing is a good probiotic. We've all heard about probiotics. We know they're good for us. We know a lot of people need them or deficient in them. I recommend taking probiotics at night before bed. Because if you're on a mold or a yeast killing protocol, you're going to take those things during the day and take the probiotic at night before bed. That way the probiotic can work at night while you're sleeping without having to try to deal with all these herbs and stuff. So that's the general recommendation, is a good probiotic at night before bed. I like Renew Life. They're the number one selling probiotic in the country. Garden of Life is a great brand. At least 50 million organisms and a blend of different strains of Acidophilus and Bifidus. So the Renew Life, there's one, they have a 50 billion one that's really good. You can take two or three of those at night before bed. Another one I really like that I'll just mention is the Primal Defense by Garden of Life, because that's a blend of probiotics with the soil organisms, which are really important too. So just any good probiotic, at least 50 billion, ideally strong or better, before bed. Minerals, that's it. Let's save it to the end, if that's okay. Minerals. Minerals are foundational for a healthy gut terrain and for an immune system and for your cells to exchange information properly. You know, you can't get water into your cells without the right minerals. There's certain minerals that are intracellular, some that are extracellular, and this osmotic pressure between the cells is how it exchanges information. So in other words, you can't get nutrients into a cell and you can't get toxic waste out of your cells without the right foundational nutrition. So that's why foods we eat matters. Taking a multivitamin is great because at least you're getting a lot of the things that your cells need to function properly. So the minerals I recommend are the Quintessence. They're ocean minerals. It's called Quintessence Bioterrain Restore. And it's actually, for over 100 years, been studied to do just that, to restore the terrain inside of our bodies, in our intestinal tract, but also in our blood and our tissues and our organs. And so it's 0.9%. It's diluted ocean water, but ocean water has the exact same mineral composition as human blood. And they did studies in this 100+ years ago in France, women who were struggling with fertility or having issues with their births, of having children having issues with their birth or deformations with their birth. They'd give them these minerals and the women would have healthy babies. The women who were infertile would start having babies again. And so I'm always been a big fan and proponent of the importance of minerals in the body. So this product you take for 1 month, there's one vial, you just drink one vial a day, and then there's a stronger one that's a 3.3, and they call that optimum mineralization. And then you can take that from there on out. So this is just to build a baseline of minerals in your body, because that helps your gut to keep unhealthy bacteria out. Just to give you an example, sea salt. It's a purifying agent. Salt purifies. That's what they, in the Old Testament, they'd actually wash the baby in salt water after they were born. That was a Jewish custom. And women, I've told before, that if they have a yeast infection, you can put a tablespoon of sea salt in a glass of warm water and drink it. It'll actually flush the infection out of your urinary tract. So these minerals aren't only important for the body and for the cellular function and restoring healthy terrain, but they also kill and remove infections from the body. So the other mineral supplement I recommend that I have lots of people have taken is the Inner Vitality Plant Minerals by Morningstar. It's a big gallon jug. It's plant minerals, has humic and fulvic minerals, same concept. Those minerals help remove infections from the body, and they provide all the trace minerals that the body needs, because the ocean minerals, the quintessence ones, are mainly electrolytes. They're really high in the magnesium, potassium, sodium, those main electrolytes that you need for everyday muscle function, nerve function, immune system function. The Inner Vitality Plant Minerals are the trace minerals. And it has nutrients in it, just like nutrients that are in the soil that keep infectious organisms off of our plants, the natural immunity that plants should have. Okay, and then I just mentioned a bowel formula, because you want your bowels moving. So if you're fighting yeast, fungus, mold, anything like that, the last thing you can afford is to be constipated. So I listed the Dr. Morse formulas here because he has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But basically formula three is if you're going every other day. Formula four is if you only go every 2 to 3 days. And formula five is if you're going like once a week. So make sure you're taking something to help keep your bowels moving. All right, so part two, killing the infection. This is challenging, and this is something that I learned that has been really helpful, because there's all kinds of great herbs and plants and therapies you can use to kill infections in the body. However, just like antibiotic resistance is going out there and super germs and super bugs, and you don't want to go in hospital, because I know people have gone to hospital and picked up MRSA and really nasty stuff. It's not pretty. I know people have gone in for routine leg surgeries and got an infection and it killed them. And this is real stuff that is happening out there, that it's not on Channel 9 News. Okay, you don't hear about all the devastation happening out there. They don't report any of that. Just the families know about it, that it happens to. But the antibiotics, because they're pharmaceutical based, the germs and the bugs adapt and change and resist them. Now, that doesn't happen as much with natural therapies, but it does to some extent, just because these are living organisms whose goal is survival. You know, when you get a mold infection in your body, it's trying to live and multiply and survive. That's why you have to stop feeding it, and you have to start exercising and getting things moving, and you got to take herbs and things to kill it. So what we found works the best is cycling herbs. Because I could list right now 30 herbs and plants and different things that kill yeast and mold. But one is people don't do it long enough. And B is they don't cycle the herbs, so that you continue to kill off all the yeast and mold and fungus organisms that are morphing and changing and trying to survive inside of your body. One of the biggest issues I've struggled with, and so many people struggle with who have ever had any type of issue like this or any kind of yeast issue, a lot of women have struggled with those issues, but certainly men too, is the yo-yo effect. Because you stop eating the sugar, you take some herbs that work, in 1 week, I mean, it doesn't take long, a few days, a week, a month at the most, you're like, wow, I feel great. I'm healed, right? And so we go back to eating bread and sugar and pasta and pizza, and we got the holidays coming up. And well, what do? It's the holidays. You just splurge. That's just life, right? And what happens? It comes raging back. It comes raging back. We haven't fully eliminated the infection. We haven't restored healthy terrain inside of our bodies. And we still have an environment in the body that's suitable for an infection to very quickly come back. And this is why people struggle with reoccurring sicknesses and poor immune systems and reoccurring respiratory issues and asthma, etc. Okay? All right, so what I recommend doing is I listed 6 products. Now, there's certainly more. There's a lot of herbs that work against these things, but I'm going to tell you what works the best, in my opinion, is oregano is probably my favorite. I only recommend North American Urban Spice. There's 50 varieties of oregano. Most companies use cheap versions or not even use oregano because there's not good quality standards. And North American Urban Spice only uses oregano that grows over 5,000 feet in Turkey and very specific places of the world. That's the strongest, most medicinal oregano on the planet. You will not find a better oregano product anywhere. So really recommend the Oreganol by North American Urban Spice. What's cool about these things that God gave us that's different than what the medical community is doing, most antibiotics are designed to kill a specific type of bacteria or something, okay? Then you can take some that just wipe out everything, right? The cool thing about oregano and some of these plants is they're germicides. They kill fungus, yeast, mold, and bacteria organisms. Okay, Clostridia is a totally different animal. It's a spore. It goes and hides. You have to pulse it. You have to do different things if you have a Clostridia infection. The Oats test from Great Plains actually tests for that too. So different organisms live and adapt and try to survive differently, and that's why you kind of got to go after it with multiple things. But the oregano, they have tested against E. coli. They've tested it against C. diff. They've tested it against all different kinds of germs and bacteria that you can think of that people struggle with. And it kills the organism just as faster than all the antibiotics. But it doesn't have all the side effects. And it has, in fact, there's plenty of benefits to taking oregano. It's great for the immune system, and it stimulates circulation, and it's great for brain and brain function. And so there's all kinds of other benefits for it, but it's one of the most powerful full-spectrum germicides that kills fungus, yeast, and mold. So I mentioned oregano. Black walnut is great for parasites and fungus, yeast organisms. Garlic. Yes, garlic. So garlic is, I mentioned a liquid one by Cedar Bear. You want the strong garlic one. I don't prefer the odorless garlic ones because it kind of takes the punch and the power out of it. We used to do, when I first started working at a health food store, you know, we still do stupid stuff, but we should just do all kinds of stupid things and try different things and experiment and whatever. And for a while we were doing garlic shooters. And so what you do is take just a little tiny bit of water, you'd squeeze a lemon in it, and then you'd squeeze through a garlic press an entire glove of garlic in it, and then you'd shoot it. And we call it garlic shooter. And if you have a cold or flu, I tell you what, it works. But garlic is extremely powerful. There's something in it called allicin, A-L-L-I-C-I-N, that is amazing for killing infections in the body. A couple of formulas I mentioned is Parasite M by Dr. Moore. So I didn't pull all the products up here. A lot of times I do a show and tell. But Parasite M has olive leaf, it has golden seal, it has pau d'arco, it has, usnea lichen. It has some of the most powerful herbs for killing microorganisms, small infectious organisms in the body. It's called Parasite M. Think of M as in like microbe. And then Herbal Fighter is a product I've used for years since I found this herbalist in Las Vegas that I know, that I worked with her pretty closely for a while. And it's a product that's got echinacea and golden seal, two very powerful herbs for the immune system, for the lymphatic system, and also for removing infections in the body. And then caprylic acid. That's one of the good things about coconut oil. A lot of people heard about benefits of coconut oil. One of the benefits is coconut oil. It kills yeast, fungus. Women will use it on the baby's butt, you know, when he gets a yeast infection or something. So you can use coconut oil because of the caprylic acid, or you can buy it in capsule form. And the way I recommend taking the herbs to kill these infections in your body is cycling them. So I wrote it out here. You can read it, but just in a nutshell, you just pick one of these things Now, the caprylic acid, you can take and cycle it like 5 days on, 5 days off. That's just my recommendation. But all the herbal formulas, you pick one formula and you take 10 drops 2 to 3 times a day for 5 days. So let's say you take the Parasite M formula. You take 10 drops, you do that 3 times a day for 5 days, and then you pick a different one. You pick garlic. You do that for 5 days, then you do oregano. You do that for 5 days, then you do herbal fighter. And you just cycle them. So what you're doing is you're continuously taking things to eliminate the infection in your body, and you're keeping it guessing. You're not giving it the same thing over and over and over again so they can go, I know what that is. I'm going to morph and change into something that doesn't affect. So this works the best, but the key is doing it as a therapy for a prolonged period of time. 3 months bare minimum. Some people need to do this like a year. Again, the issue is people do it for a week. I feel amazing. They stop the herbs. They start eating all the breads and pasta and pizza and crackers because we've all done it because we all love it. And what happens? We don't feel good again. Okay, so we can live on that roller coaster. That's, you know, that was my life for many, many years on that sugar addiction roller coaster, but we don't have to live there. Part 3, cleaning the pipes. That's just what I called it. We got to become a free-flowing river again. We got to clean out the colon, the kidneys, the lymph, the liver. We have to free the debris and the junk and the waste and the garbage backed up in these organs because that's sickness and disease. That's cancer. That's heart disease. We know heart disease is blocked up arteries, right? We know it. But all these sicknesses and diseases are from a blocked, congested, stagnant system. And so that's why on our website, if you go to cleanses and programs, we have a colon cleanse, we have a lymph cleanse, we have a kidney cleanse, we have a liver cleanse, we have what's called a microbe cleanse. That's more full spectrum for parasites and any different types of infections. This is more specific for mold and yeast. So that's why they're different. So I really encourage people to cleanse because that is what's going to bring healing and breakthrough long term again. Do you want to be able to eat Ezekiel bread every day and it not affect you? We should be able to. We should be able to. We should be able to eat, you know, maple syrup and healthy versions of sweet things. Okay, those aren't evil things, right? We've kind of made them out to be because of the struggles that so many people are having in their bodies, but they shouldn't have to be. It's not so much the food, it's our bodies and the breakdown of our bodies and the way the bodies are. The organs aren't working right, digestion's not working right, the infections that have taken over the bodies, that we get that stuff cleaned out. And you know what? You don't have to fear sickness and disease. It doesn't matter what your mom and dad had. It doesn't matter if 5 generations back, every single person in your family had diabetes. It doesn't matter. You don't have to. If we believe that, you're believing what the worldly system says. You're not believing what God says about you. And you can choose differently than everybody else has chosen. Because again, we didn't just have those diseases strike us out of nowhere. We have to choose differently. Now, we might have been dealt a bad hand. I like to say that. Okay, genetics plays a role. There's 1-year-olds that are sick, not because they made bad choices in their life, right? That 1-year-old didn't make horrible, bad, sinful choices his entire life to get him sick, right? So, but growing up, he or she is going to have to learn how to do things differently than clearly their parents and their grandparents did to have a good life, a healthy life, a good chance at life. Because a lot of kids are really, really struggling today. There's epidemics of autism and ADHD and cancer and diabetes even in young kids. That's epic, that's never been seen before. So it's really sad to see. What I put about cleansing is that while people are cleansing, they usually feel sick, they get cold flu symptoms. These are all good things. I want you to get sick. If you're doing the right things, I want you to get sick. Because you should, and you probably will. There's a guy I'm working with right now that I'm not going to say who he is, but he's had a long history of smoking and doing some things, and he's going through a cleanse right now, and he is struggling. He can hardly get out of bed. His throat hurts so bad it feels like it's closed. He can hardly catch a breath. And his body's trying to expel all this mucus in the waste that's been built up for years. But you know what? He's going for it. He's going for it to eliminate this sickness and disease out of his body so that he can live a longer life and do what God called him to do on this earth. Because you know what he could do? He could start eating and it would all go away. He could start eating bread and sweets and pasta, and the pain would go away, the misery would go away, the cleansing effect would go away. He might still not feel great 100%. He might still be a little bit tired. But you feed back into the sickness and disease. You feed the infection again, and it relaxes, and your body stops the healing and cleansing process, and you can go right back to status quo. But he's going to try to choose differently. He's going to try to eliminate the sickness out of his body. And it's not easy to do that. It's not easy to do that. And very few people are going to choose to do that. You know, people are not dying of old age. People are dying prematurely of sickness and disease. And it's almost always related to an infection. I don't know if anybody here knows anybody who does autopsies or who's a mortician. But they see things that you wouldn't ever want to talk about. The black, the decay, what it looks like on the inside of a body when somebody's passed is it's beyond comprehension. And we don't even think about it or know about it while we're living because we can't see it. So step four, I put additional therapies, just other great things you can do. Baking soda, you know, it kills fungus and yeast and mold. You know, we use it in our bathtubs and our showers and our refrigerator to keep everything fresh. And you can actually put a little bit in water and drink it every day. It's the bicarbonate minerals are great for the kidneys. It kills fungus and yeast and mold on contact. That's what Dr. C. Messina used, this doctor in Italy, who lost his license for curing people of cancer with baking soda. This is what he used to see cancer tumors go away, is he used baking soda. So you just put a little bit in water and drink it, best on an empty stomach. You don't want to dilute your stomach acid while you're eating food. So it's good on an empty stomach. Sauna. Dry sauna, not the heat sauna, not the wet sauna, you know, the steam, not the steam sauna. A dry, far infrared sauna or infrared sauna. Or there's near and far, and I don't know all the difference between them, but a dry sauna, the heat kills infection. What happens when you get sick? You get a fever. That's the body's natural mechanism to heat up. That's God's design to heat up to kill and eradicate an infection in your body. And so a sauna will heat up your body and kill infection in your body. It'll also help you sweat because there's only three ways to get waste out of the human body, right? Poop, pee, and sweat. And people are sick, and if you're not eliminating properly or doing enemas or having dark, cloudy, stinky pee or sweating, all the toxic waste is staying trapped in the body. And so that's why people don't get well. That's why a pharmaceutical drug will never make you well. It might make you feel temporarily better, but it won't make you well. You will never have the fullness of God's design. Like it almost seems like a fantasy these days for our bodies to work and function the way God designed them. And can you imagine like how amazingly powerful like Adam was? Like I can't even imagine that. Like how well his body functioned and the way he thought, like even after sin, beyond comprehension, a million times more strong and powerful than we are today. Just so much genetic weakness passed down. But God has promised us fullness and he's promised us restoration. But we really have to go for it. Enemas, I'm a fan of. It just helps people feel better. It eliminates infection more quickly. There's black walnut. You can use baking soda. You can use all kinds of different herbs and things to kill infection in your colon, in your body. It not only removes waste out of your colon, but all the gut-associated lymphatic tissue that it's all around your, that's around your intestines. It's lymphatic tissue. And all that stuff needs to be cleaned out. So that's the answer long-term, is cleansing. And that's why so many people will succumb to sickness and disease and won't live long, healthy lives, is because we were never taught and we never learned to cleanse, or we're so ingrained in food and the foods that we like and pleasure us and that we're addicted to that we won't break out of that to restore health in our bodies. And that's just the reality of our world today. It's just like anything in your walk with the Lord, it's a choice to turn away from destructive things. It's a choice to turn back to the author of life, to choose back to God. You know, whether your issue is alcohol or pornography or food, these are things that, you know, we have to make the decision, and we have to make the difficult choices, and we have to make the change. And it doesn't happen to happen overnight. It can be a transition. It's a process. You know, I don't want everybody to feel guilty about the holidays now. And oh my gosh, I went to Thanksgiving, I ate a piece of pie. You know, like we don't want condemnation over this, but we have to learn the reality of what it takes to heal our bodies. And we're not doing it. We're not doing what it takes to heal our bodies. Because it takes discipline, and it takes self-control, and it takes work, and it takes being different from everybody else. And it takes your family and friends saying things about you that they shouldn't say, that they don't have any right to say, but they choose to say it. Probably because they're convicted by your choices to go morally a different way. Which I know we've probably all experienced that in some arena of our lives. So anyway, that was it. Blessings. Amen. If anybody has any questions, comments.
Potatoes, that sweet potatoes also?
Yes, potatoes would include sweet potatoes. Not as much of an extent, but yes, it's a starchy food. And so it's going to include potatoes. So what I always tell people is, you know, if you like sweet potatoes, there's a give and take here, right? Let's say you love sweet potatoes. You really love sweet potatoes. But you also eat ice cream and bread and crackers and pasta. If you give all that other stuff up and you just eat sweet potatoes, that's a fair trade to me. Do you see what I'm saying? There's got to be a give and take. So, because we're always so particular about each and every food or whatever. Well, it depends on where you're at. So if you're just starting to make changes, you know, get rid of all the worst stuff first. Yeah. You know, if you're eating ice cream at night, every night before bed, yeah, eat your sweet potato. If you cut out the ice cream, right?
Does butternut squash fall in that category?
Butternut squash is a starchy vegetable. It's not as bad. Body Ecology diet, she recommends mainly staying away from corn and potatoes. Squash is a little bit more on the starchy side. I would just limit it. I wouldn't say it's like ixnade from the candida list. It's better than sweet potato, for sure. It's definitely better than sweet potato. Yes. Anything else? Yes.
You mentioned a probiotic. What about kimchi?
Yes. So he said, you mentioned probiotics. What about kimchi? So with yeast, fungal, mold issues, I recommend sauerkraut, kimchi, or any fermented vegetables. Ideally, well, I was going to say not in vinegar, but it shouldn't be in vinegar if it's fermented, okay? Because vinegar kills infections, and it feeds yeast. Not to do dairy, so no yogurt or kefir. A lot of people would disagree and say all the healthy organisms in yogurt and kefir are very good for these issues. Yes, but from my experience, the dairy is too heavy, mucus forming, congesting. People got blocked lymphatic systems, livers aren't working. You're just not going to do well in dairy, period. And then kombucha is a wild fermentation that actually feeds yeast and fungus in the body. So I do not recommend kombucha for these issues either. So I only recommend sauerkraut or kimchi and good probiotics.
Say that again about the kombucha.
Kombucha is a wild fermentation. It feeds yeast and fungus, just like wine does, just like beer does. Beer is about, you want to know like the single worst thing you could put in the human body, in my opinion, is beer. Let me tell you a story real quick. This is a good story. Do I have enough time on the camera? Okay. I learned this just this last, I have to share this with you. I've been meaning to share this in a class and it hasn't come up. Okay, you guys have all heard of Pocahontas. Okay, we went to Henricus, which is the second settlement built after Jamestown. It's where Pocahontas lived and where she met with the pastor to learn English. So not only did she learn the American way, or probably more like the English way, right? The English civilized way, and learning about the Bible and learning about English language and all that, she also started eating the food that they ate. Now in Pocahontas, first started learning all this, she was really young. She was about 16. And she ate the Native American diet, right? They ate squash and corn, and they ate deer and animals that they caught, and rabbit, and you know, this is what they ate. When she met the English settlers, you know what their three main foods were? I'll tell you what are their three main foods? Anybody have any idea? Beer was one.
Potatoes.
Nope. Bread was one. And cheese. Beer, bread, and cheese. I mean, what are people still addicted to today, right? Beer, bread, and cheese. Okay, she had never seen these foods before in her life. Why did they drink beer? Because they didn't have a good way to sanitize and purify water. And the beer was fermented. So that was the main beverage that they drank was beer. So beer, bread, and cheese. She started eating beer, bread, and cheese. She always complained of stomach issues and stomach problems after she started eating that. And she was deathly sick. There's a couple pictures that an artist drew of her, and she looks thin, she looks gaunt. She almost looks like she has rheumatoid arthritis, like her fingers are starting to cripple. They brought her over to England. And in England, it's all like hoity-toity, you know, party after party. She's probably drinking alcohol, eating cheese, eating bread. How many people know Pocahontas was dead at 21? So healthy Native American living off of the land started eating this civilized English food, suffered for those 5 years, and was dead in 5 years, dead at 21. Who's heard that story? This is the result of choosing these foods and this type of a lifestyle. Now, it was different back then for the settlers. Their bodies were used to it. They were working outside. They were sweating, building stuff, or whatever. They didn't die because they were eating beer and bread, okay? But our culture's different. Our foods are different. Our environment's different. We're sedentary. We don't move and exercise and sweat like we used to. You have to be super intentional to be healthy today. Don't end up like Pocahontas. I just wanted to share that. I thought that was good. Okay, was there any other questions? Yes.
Is a HEPA filter okay to use?
I actually didn't mention the filters. I'm glad you mentioned it. We have the Volara Air Fresh systems. It's an ozone machine. It actually puts ozone into the air, and that's what you want, because ozone will kill mold and fungus on contact. It'll hit it, it'll render it inert, it'll fall right out. And they got tests and stuff that they can show that to you in a little bubble. But so I think anything that puts oxygen into the air, like ozone, hydrogen peroxide kills mold. You know, you can use that. I don't know about just a regular, he might speak more, but just in a plain old HEPA filter, I'm sure if it's a super high quality, like official HEPA filters, because I know there's a lot of not good brands out there, I think it probably does help to some extent. But I know the ozone machines work great for killing the mold. Yes, sure. Anything else?
Can you say more about that kombucha?
Oh, yeah. Oh, that was your question. I never answered your question.
The reason I'm asking is because I just made it.
Okay. So beer, wine, they're called wild fermentations. There's actually a book out called Wild Fermentation, but it's a different process of fermentation. I don't fully understand it. I'm not a fermentation expert, but sauerkraut and kimchi are fermented. Beer and wine are fermented. Beer and wine will make your yeast and fungus in your body go crazy, flip out. Sauerkraut and kimchi will actually be healing to the body, good for your healthy bacteria. It's a difference in the fermentation process. And maybe actually the fact that sauerkraut and kimchi are from vegetables, sauerkraut, versus a base that's grapes or fruit sugar or the grains, you know, which we talked about the issue with grains and mold and stuff like that. And the kombucha is a bacteria of culture and yeast. It's called a SCOBY. Yeah. I don't know if anybody really knows what it is. Some people say it's a mushroom. I've heard it's not really a mushroom. It's a culture of bacteria and yeast. I don't know where it came from or where it originated from, but I know the process of fermentation is a process that will feed yeast and fungus in the body if you have it. I know this from experience with working with people, but also in Body Ecology Diet, Donna Gates knows this and does not recommend kombucha for that purpose. But if you don't have those issues, people talk all the time about how great kombucha is.
It's probiotic.
Right, probiotic, good for digestion, got B vitamins in it. There's a lot of benefits to kombucha, but if you have a yeast fungus issue, you're not going to do well on it. All right. Okay, yes, last question.
Do you have a resource or recommendation for like inspecting your home, correct?
I don't. I've never hired I don't think I've ever had to hire a mold remediator or somebody, but I'm sure they're in the phone book. I just don't know anybody personally. He might. All right. Amen. Thanks.
Thank you.